Up until now, we have looked at two main objects, vectors and bivectors. Vectors represent oriented line segments, which are one-dimensional, and bivectors are built from oriented plane segments, which are two-dimensional. Are there higher-dimensional analogs to vectors and bivectors? That is what we will look at in this video. This video is a part of From Zero to Geo, a series where we formulate geometric algebra, an incredibly powerful branch of mathematics, from the ground up. To see what the higher dimensional analogs of vectors and bivectors are, let's review what exactly vectors and bivectors themselves are. A vector is an oriented line segment, and a bivector is an oriented plane segment. So we can extend this to higher dimensions by thinking of things like oriented volume segments, which we'll call trivectors, or even oriented higher dimensional segments, which we'll call k-vectors for a given dimension k. But wait, what is a higher dimensional segment? And how could we orient it? Let's look a little closer at vectors and bivectors again to get a clearer picture. We can split a vector into three parts: the line the vector is in, the orientation inside the line, which can only go in two directions, and its magnitude. Bivectors can also be split into three parts: the plane the bivector is in, the orientation inside the plane, which can only go in two directions, and its magnitude. So let's focus on these three parts separately and see how we can extend them to higher dimensions. First, the line or plane that the object is in. What do lines and planes have in common? Well, notice that a line is a one-dimensional subspace and a plane is a two-dimensional subspace. So we can extend this idea to subspaces in higher dimensions. In general, we build our objects out of subspaces. So how do we orient these subspaces? This actually turns out to be quite difficult to conceptualize. We have already seen how one-dimensional and two-dimensional orientations work, and you can make three-dimensional orientations work with enough effort, but we can't really visualize orientations involving higher-dimensional objects. However, in many cases, we don't have to. Notice that once we have picked a subspace for a vector or a bivector, there are only two possible orientations. This holds for higher-dimensional objects as well. Once we have picked a subspace, there are only two orientations, and we can just call them positive and negative and keep track of the orientation with algebra. The final property that we need to generalize is the magnitude. Thankfully, this one is pretty easy. The magnitude of a vector can be thought of as a length, the magnitude of a bivector can be thought of as an area, and we can generalize with things like volumes and hypervolumes. So in general, our objects are built from a subspace, one of two orientations within that subspace, and a magnitude. Now, one question you may ask is, how does this all work with the fact that some bivectors are not blades? Well, we have the same issue with these higher dimensional objects as well. Some trivectors are not blades, some four vectors are not blades, and so on. However, there are some special cases where it's easy to know if something is a blade or not, which I'll cover later. Just like how we can define bivectors as the span of all two blades, we can define trivectors as the span of all three blades, and in general, we can define k-vectors as the span of all k-blades. But wait, how do we calculate these spans? We haven't defined any operations on these higher dimensional objects yet. Well, scaling should be easy. You just multiply the magnitude by a scalar, and multiplying by a negative scalar will flip the orientation. But what about addition? As we get to these higher dimensional objects, doing addition geometrically gets quite difficult. However, notice that even though adding bivectors is geometrically more complicated than adding vectors, algebraically the process is the exact same. So maybe we should try to do the same thing with higher dimensional objects. All we need to do is find a basis and then add using that. But wait, this is all backwards. So far, for each kind of object, we have been defining the operations, proving that the operations turn the objects into a linear space, and then we use the fact that it's a linear space to build a basis. We can't have a basis without having a linear space first, right? Well, even though we have been doing everything up to this point by doing the geometry first and then building the algebra on top of it, it's possible to go the other way around. We can build the algebra first and then use the algebra to describe the geometry. To build the algebra, we can find what we think a basis should be, and then just make a linear space with those things as the basis. We can then reattach the geometry afterwards. So let's try to generalize the vector and bivector bases to higher dimensional objects. In n-dimensional space, vectors have a basis given by n vectors. Looking at four dimensions for the moment, we can pick all the possible pairs of vectors to get the 4D bivector basis. If the bivector basis can be found by looking at all the possible ways to pick two of the basis vectors, maybe we can get a trivector basis by looking at all the possible ways to pick three of the basis vectors. From each of these sets of three, we can make a trivector. The trivector E123 represents the subspace spanned by E1, E2, and E3. The trivector E124 represents the subspace spanned by E1, E2, and E4, and so on. Again, we can't really visualize the orientation of these trivectors too easily, but we can describe the orientation algebraically by saying that all of these trivectors have a positive orientation, and then the other orientation will be negative. These trivectors will be our basis for 4D trivectors. In general, we can form a basis for K vectors by finding all of the ways to choose K of the basis vectors. This makes a linear space that we can use to describe K vectors. Now, this is normally the point where I would give you an exercise asking you to calculate a bunch of linear combinations of things like trivectors or higher dimensional K vectors. However, as I said earlier, these operations are algebraically identical to those for vectors. I don't want to bore you with doing the same thing as before for vectors and bivectors, so I won't give any exercises like this. It's actually been surprisingly difficult to make good exercises in this chapter. The geometry is hard to do, so I feel like I can't give you any geometric exercises, and the algebra is mostly the same as before until we get to the next chapter, so I feel like algebraic exercises don't add anything new. However, there is one thing I want to touch on that I will turn into an exercise. Remember that in four dimensions, bivectors are algebraically six-dimensional. Can you find the algebraic dimension of arbitrary K vectors in arbitrary geometric dimensions? If you want a hint, look at all of the algebraic dimensions we know so far and see if you can find a pattern. Please pause the video and solve this problem before continuing. To solve this, like I suggested in my hint, let's look at the algebraic dimensions we know so far. Let's make a table with the dimension of the space we are working in on the left and the dimension of the object on the top. The entries in this table will be the algebraic dimension. For vectors, the algebraic dimension is simply the dimension of the space we are working in. For bivectors, in 2D they have one component, in 3D they have three components, and in 4D they have six components. We haven't looked at trivectors too much yet, but we saw that in 4D they have four components, and it shouldn't be too hard to convince you that in 3D they have one component. Seeing the numbers laid out like this, they may look familiar. These are just some of the numbers of Pascal's triangle. However, there are some numbers on the left that don't correspond to any object. Should something go here? Well, scalars always have one component, so we can put them in the table too, which will fill in this gap. We've found a pattern now, but how can we prove that the algebraic dimension always matches Pascal's triangle? Well, remember that the numbers in Pascal's triangle are also called binomial coefficients, and they represent the number of ways to pick k things from n objects. You often read this notation as n choose k, and you can calculate binomial coefficients using this formula. Remember that we get the basis for k vectors in n-dimensional space by finding all of the ways to pick k of the n basis vectors. This produces exactly n choose k different basis k vectors. Since the definition of algebraic dimension is the size of a basis, this proves that the algebraic dimension of k vectors in n-dimensional space is n choose k. There's one more thing I want to point out with this table. Each row represents a different dimension, while each column represents a different dimension. Wait, those are the same thing! Of course, the rows represent the dimension of the space we are working in, while the columns represent the dimension of the object we are talking about, but it's still confusing to describe both the rows and the columns using the word dimension. To make matters worse, the entries in this table are another kind of dimension. Once again, we see that dimension is multidimensional. To fix this, we like to use the term grade to describe the dimension of the objects involved. Thus, vectors are grade 1 objects, bivectors are grade 2 objects, and so on. Using this term can reduce the confusion that the term dimension can have. Interestingly, we see here that scalars are grade 0. So in some sense, scalars can be considered to be zero-dimensional. Now, I recognize that this video might be hard to follow with how abstract it has been. Since we're discussing objects that we can't visualize, it is difficult to talk about them. You may be wondering, how do we even use these higher grade objects? Well, it turns out that they are much less useful than vectors and bivectors. That's why I made several videos about vectors and bivectors, but only one for higher grade objects. These higher grade objects do pop up when working with geometric algebra, but you don't usually need to visualize them. Often, their use is purely algebraic, with them canceling out in the final result. So if you had a hard time following this video, don't worry. The main takeaway is that these higher grade objects do exist, and that they form linear spaces. At this point, we have many different kinds of geometric objects. We know how to add one object to another object of the same kind, and we know how to multiply these objects by scalars. However, what about adding different kinds of objects together? That is what we will look at in the next video.